So in the past 50 years or so, these cycles or these periods where the Fed has had to leave rates elevated have lasted between 200 and 400 days.
Where are we at in this cycle, Neal?
We're on day 310. So I think this is what concerns Jerome Powell greatly.
All right, Neal Falkenberry, Managing Director, Modern Wealth in our Reston, Virginia office. Welcome. It's great to have you here.
All right. Thank you, Dean. Thank you, Bud. It's a great time to get together to review inflation and where the Fed's fight against inflation stands.
Yeah. So now, before we get too far into this, Bud, you had a take a while back, and anybody that's been listening to America's Wealth Management Show knows your take. So it's going to be really, really interesting to get Neal's take here. But you thought that the Fed waited way too long to start raising rates in the first place, and they let inflation overheat, right?
Yes. Yeah, I believe that. But as we look at this going forward, this was a win for the Federal Reserve today because it really allows them that perhaps in the last 6 months of the year to actually start to decrease the rate again. So we'll see what happens. But I was going to say one time this year. I think I may have to amend that to two times before the end of the year.
All right. Well, now. So, Neal, you are a chartered financial analyst, a CFA, and there are not a lot of CFAs out there that are actually financial advisors as well. So I want to start by having you explain what a chartered financial analyst is and why that's important.
Chartered financial analyst is an accreditation program, takes a minimum of 3 years to get through. It covers economic analysis, ethics, security selection, quantitative analysis, portfolio management, really covers the full gamut required to be a portfolio manager and a financial advisor. I took the route of working as a financial advisor over being a fund manager because of the joy of working with individuals and helping families solve their financial problems and bringing an element really of understanding markets and then learning the financial planning side of the business as opposed to maybe going in the opposite direction.
So there's been a lot happening over the last couple of years with inflation. I mean, all eyes have been on the Federal Reserve and the policies that they have in place today. We had I think we're in the middle still of an enormous rally in the stock market that started last October when Jerome Powell hinted that there was probably 6 rate cuts in the future. And I think the market took it to mean there were 6 rate cuts coming really, really soon. Did you think that was the case, or where do you think we're at today as far as this idea that the Fed could potentially cut rates?
Yeah, I agree. The market certainly heard 6 rate cuts and celebrated that with a great rally. Now, it's questionable whether or not the market might be a bit ahead of itself. So to give you the best answer, I think it might help to review a typical Fed rate hike cycle, review the evidence, and point to why I think Chairman Powell is so obsessed here with cutting interest rates, in spite of the data suggesting that it might even need to go the other direction, right?
Okay.
We have a stock market that's at an all-time high. We've had 10-year bond yields come down about 80 basis points. The job number last Friday was still very hot. Certainly, financial conditions are not tight, right, which is the goal of the Fed raising interest rates. And yet he seems to at any point want to look for an excuse to cut interest rates. So let's review a cycle real quick and see if we can come up with an understanding of why he might take that position.
Neal, before you dig into this chart here, I just want to let everybody know that's listening to us on either radio or on your favorite podcast app. You can also catch America's Wealth Management Show on YouTube, where you can actually get a chance to meet us because you'll see us, and then you'll get to see some of the things that we share as well. So Neal has a chart here, inflation forces the Federal Reserve to raise interest rates. And Neal, walk us through this chart and help us understand what you're talking about here and why you think he might have to go the other way, counter to Bud's idea that maybe there's 2 rate cuts between now and the end of the year.
Yeah, certainly. So the chart is a plot of the Fed funds interest rate going back since the 1970s. And it shows that the Fed has these typical cycles where the Fed will meet typically every other month. They'll raise interest rates a quarter of a point, sometimes a half of a point. They'll leave rates elevated for some period of time, and then they'll begin to cut rates once they believe they've solved the problem of inflation and hopefully do it just in time to slow the economy but not cause a recession. Right. The evidence, though, suggests that it doesn't work exactly with that precision. Right. So also overlaid on the chart are shaded arrows that denote recessions. And the first walk away from this chart is that most Fed rate hike cycles, the vast majority of Fed rate hike cycles, actually precede recessions, right? So meaning that rate hike cycle is leading to an increase of cost of capital, slows the economy, and ultimately we get a recession as opposed to the preferred and fairly elusive soft landing, right? Where the economy has growth slow to maybe 1%, but doesn't technically go negative, right?
Right. Well, maybe if they want to get the soft landing, they could hire Sully Sullenberger and he could come in and take care of that.
Right. So think about this part, where we are in the cycle. So if you take any one of these cycles on the chart, but I think the easiest one to visualize would be that 2005 to 2008 cycle. See, the Fed takes a very gradual stair-step approach to raising interest rates. Again, they meet every other month or so. They raise rates 25 or 50 basis points, right? That's the first part of the cycle. The second part of the cycle is that the Fed raises rates to a level where the economy starts to push back a little bit, right? Where the economy is saying these higher interest rates are going to be problematic for the economy, okay? That's the point where I think phase two begins, which is the period where the Fed has to leave rates elevated for an extended period of time. This is the part that probably of the cycle that's discussed the least, but here's why, where most of the work takes place in a Fed cycle. So if you have a fixed rate mortgage, for example, you're not that concerned that the Fed has been raising interest rates. If your business has a balloon note, 5-year balloon note on your building or your manufacturing facility, you don't care that much when rates rise. But if now your family has gotten larger, you have to move, have a new job, your car comes off a lease, right? There's an embedded interest rate in a car lease. Any kind of building, an adjustable rate mortgage gets reset. Now you get pulled into the higher interest rate pool. And that's where discretionary income disappears, right? Or where margin disappears from business. And that's where typically layoffs begin in that part of the cycle. So in the past 50 years or so, these cycles or these periods where the Fed has had to leave rates elevated have lasted between 200 and 400 days.
And where are we at in this cycle, Neal?
We're on day 310 today.
Okay.
So I think this is what concerns Jerome Powell greatly. I think he sees that interest rates have now been elevated. We've kept them elevated at these rates. Mortgage rates have now been over 7% for 13 consecutive months. We're now just reaching that point in the cycle where higher interest rates matter, right? That we've had enough debt maturities, reset at higher rates, discretionary spending and margin is now disappearing, right, as it's going to service higher debt. And we're just now in that window where the effects on the economy become pretty clear. And I think this is why Chairman Powell is looking for a reason to cut interest rates, because he knows the longer he maintains rates at this level, the higher the probability comes that we have a recession or a significant economic slowdown.
Right.
Okay. So that all that makes sense. And I totally agree. And I think Bud does too. But you said something at the very beginning, which is you think he may have to go the other way. What leads you to believe that?
Well, so today we have a CPI number that's 3.3%, right? A little better than expected, but inflation peaked June 2022 at 9.1%. It came down to a low of 3% this time last year. And since then, we've been bouncing between 3 and 3.5, and we're still at 3.3 today, right? So we're right in the middle of that inflation range. We've not made any progress now in the last year, right? So that suggests that there are still very much inflationary pressures in the economy, right? And then anecdotally, you look at the market, we're at an all-time high in the market today. That certainly suggests that financial conditions are not tight. We've seen the 10-year Treasury come down about 80 basis points from its peak. The jobs number still looks strong. Try booking a hotel or an airline ticket, right? So, right. I mean, the economy is continuing to do very well. That suggests that financial conditions are not tight enough to get inflation down to the Fed's 2% inflation target, and that there's more work to be done, either A, raising rates, which I think is completely off the table, or B, leaving rates elevated at this same elevated rate level we have now, allowing even more maturities to come in, allowing more discretionary income to be pulled away from the economy into debt service. So I don't think he wants to raise rates. I know he wants to cut rates, and he's very concerned. I mean, no Fed chairman wants to preside over a recession, certainly in an election year, I think.
Right.
But the reality is that we've not made any substantial progress on inflation now in a year, and there are indications that in the system, there are some things that look a little bit better in terms of forward inflation, but there's other measures that suggest that there's still inflationary pressures building. So I think there's more work to be done, and I think that comes in the form of the Fed wanting to cut rates, but not being able to do so and having to sit on their hands for at least another, you know, 3 or 6 months, perhaps.
Okay, so here's the thing. We know that everything that the Fed does affects the economy and affects the markets, whether it's the stock market or the bond market. And you and I had a conversation here a few weeks ago, and we said, hey, let's not do this phrase, don't fight the Fed. But you got to understand the Fed and understand how what the Federal Reserve does impacts the capital markets, because that ultimately impacts your individual wealth. Mm-hmm. And so if you have something that I think is really interesting here, because you have a current administration that wants to get inflation under control. They want to go into this election cycle in November saying, hey, look what we did. We brought inflation down, and things are better now than what they were. But this administration is doing exactly the opposite of what they should be doing in order to actually bring down inflation, because I think the fiscal decisions that are taking place in Washington today are actually exacerbating the inflation problem. What's your take on that?
I agree completely. And I think this is the perhaps least understood challenge we see in capital markets today from investors. So on one hand, we have the Fed, which is monetary policy, raising rates, trying to slow the economy to cool inflation. And on the other hand, we have fiscal policy, which is the spending in Washington, where we're now running the fourth largest deficit in history. Right. So deficit spending is pro-growth, pro-inflation, right? So it is pulling future growth into the present, right?
So I think this chart is fascinating, Neal, because, you know, it goes way back, as this going back into the 70s as well. And the deficit spending is just off the charts through every single cycle. I think we see one cycle where we didn't have deficit spending, and I think that was the Clinton administration, right?
Correct. So we're running a deficit currently about 6% of GDP. So think about that for a second. You know, if the economy grows 3% in a normal year, you know, we are borrowing 3 years worth of growth to bring into the present, right? Now, we've never had a recession begin with a deficit larger than 5%. It's very difficult to have a recession when you're borrowing that much future growth into, you know, current consumption, right? So the level of this deficit compares, you know, the largest deficit we ran in history was World War II.
Sure.
Second one was COVID. The third was the great financial crisis. We are running a deficit very close to the level we ran in the great financial crisis in 2008 and 9 today, while we're at full employment, right? Normally, it is logical for governments to run deficits in recessions when unemployment is 8, 10, or 12%. But we have a very tight labor market. Unemployment is still in the threes, right? 3.9%. We're at full employment, which is, again, part of the battle that the Fed is having to fight, right, is to try to raise our interest rates to slow that potential inflation and economic growth. And yet we're running these large deficits. So it is really entirely inconsistent with the Fed. And I'm not a fan of the word unprecedented. I think we use that too frequently. But I can't find examples in history of running deficits of this magnitude that run counter to what the Federal Reserve is trying to do with the economy. So one wants slow growth, one wants aggressive growth.
So the sustainability under the current pressure that we have from the amount of debt that we have has got to have an impact from an economic perspective. So based upon what you've shared with us so far and looking into your crystal ball, what's your anticipation that the market will be at the end of the year?
Pete, I think it's challenging to see equities much higher. I mean, I think equities have certainly discounted a lot of good news, which is a celebration that the Fed is going to cut interest rates, right? But if you reflect back on my first chart for a moment, you know, we talked about the three parts of a Fed cycle, right? There's the raising of rates, the keeping them elevated, and then the cutting. Normally, the first cut is problematic, right? The Fed is cutting rates for a reason, and that reason is that it sees that the economy is softening in response to higher economic growth. And yet the market is celebrating interest rates cuts as if the Fed is going to have the perfect soft landing, that it is going to be able to engineer, get inflation back to that 2% target without causing a recession, and the market is giving Chairman Powell the benefit of the doubt. Many people think he's done a good job, many think he's done a poor job, but I think the market is certainly giving him the benefit of the doubt that he's going to get the job done of getting inflation under control. So I'm not a market timer. You know, I believe in sticking to our asset allocation and our plans, but if you really force me to say what's priced into markets, I would say today that the market has really priced for perfection in terms of execution by the Fed, of backing off interest rates, not too late, not too early, and triggering that just perfect scenario, Goldilocks scenario, where you have still positive economic growth, but continue to see inflation come down. That seems challenging in my view.
And how much of the election is into these numbers?
But I don't think the election matters. I would frankly not put it in my list of top five things to worry about. You know, if we look at the two candidates, President Trump, during his term, ran large deficits. They weren't this large, but remember, the Fed was raising rates in 2018-19. The economy, during his administration, the economy was softening. We looked to be heading into a recession before COVID made sure we got there, right? And in anticipation of that, we were running deficits of about 4% of GDP, right? Now President Biden is running deficits of 6% or larger. So I think both are very comfortable with debt. Both are very comfortable with the use of deficits to try to engineer growth. I don't think there's much difference between them from an investment perspective of what this means for markets, which is we have an inflation problem. We have a Federal Reserve that's trying to fight that in problem. We have a group of policies in Washington, D.C. that are either reluctant to let the Fed's work go ahead and do what it needs to do, which is probably cause the recession to get inflation truly out of the system, right? Or we're running deficits to fund a number of causes that we just believe are worthy, and deficits is just the cost of doing business. So, yeah, I don't think we have to know what the motives are in Washington, just to know that from our perspective, the investment ramifications are this is the battlefield. You know, the Fed trying to fight inflation and Washington trying to stall the effects of that inflation fight.
Neal, you said something a minute ago that I want to challenge you on. And you said that the market is priced for perfection. So it's priced as if the Fed's going to engineer this perfect soft landing and we're going to have kind of this Goldilocks scenario that we almost never see. You look at the price earnings ratio on the S&P 500, we're in excess of 27 at this point in time, which from a historical perspective is really high. It's overpriced. But at the same time, you have a lot of the market, a lot of the companies out there that their stocks are trading at literal discounts to what I would consider to be fair value. So if you say the market is fairly valued or overvalued, I think that is that's not necessarily a true statement, because I think there's a select group of companies that are actually driving that overvaluation, while you have a lot of companies that are fairly valued or undervalued, where there's a lot less risk there. In fact, maybe there's opportunity as opposed to looking at the market being overvalued. What are your thoughts there?
Great point. I agree with you completely. Right. So yeah, my statement about a market price for perfection, can be reviewed, I think, in that light. You know, and I think this is an environment where professional investment managers really can add value to clients. There are some actual pretty cheap parts of the market, right? Certainly emerging markets, some international markets, U.S. small cap value, for example. There are some opportunities where a manager can rebalance a portfolio to take advantage of those things, right? However, there's some risks to that, right? I mean, some of those efforts to diversify away from just large tech growth certainly have been punitive here in the past 2 years, could continue to do so. You know, if the Fed does proceed to cut rates, I mean, generally that's very positive for some of these large cap growth names. But I agree with your point. I think there are certainly points in the marketplace that are valuable or more attractively valued. But you've got to go looking a little bit deeper than, I think, just the S&P 500.
Yeah, no, I would totally agree. Bud, you're right on that with that, aren't you?
Yes, I am. Give us a comment or two, if you will, on the Magnificent Seven and the impact on the index.
And just so you know, Neal, we got a minute and a half left here, so about a minute from you on the Magnificent Seven.
I mean, it's remarkable just the extent of how concentrated the S&P 500's performance has become in just a handful of names. And even more specifically, just down to NVIDIA, Microsoft, just really two or three names. This is generally not very healthy for the market. You know, if you go back and look at the dot-com era, and I'm not suggesting an exact parallel between dot-com and the AI era, but I don't think there's anything we're experiencing today in terms of Magnificent Seven versus the Nifty 50 in the 1970s or some of the big Cisco-type names in the dot-com era. We know there's real risk to remaining concentrated in those positions. Sure. And so whether you are diversifying away from some of those names, taking advantage of some of the more attractively parts of the market that we just discussed, seems like a very reasonable step at this point. But right. I think the risks are pretty high, even though I'm extremely bullish on AI. We have to separate bullishness from what's priced into stocks.
Thanks for joining us here on America's Wealth Management Show. I'm Dean Barber, along with Bud Kasper, with our special guest, Neal Falkenberry. Be on the lookout for our next episode with Neal, where we will define risk in both equities and fixed income. Until next time, everybody stay healthy and stay safe.
Represent the opinion of Modern Wealth Management, LLC, an SEC-registered investment advisor. Information provided is for illustrative purposes only and does not constitute investment, tax, or legal advice. Modern Wealth Management does not accept any liability for the use of the information discussed. Consult with a qualified financial, legal, or tax professional prior to taking any action.